Bonjour, bonjour, everyone. So we are back here. This is Daniela, Nomads View and Guide Collective. And I'm already out and about. And as you see, olives behind me, beautiful countryside. I'm in the Côte d'Iron wine area. And I don't want to make this longer as necessary. I'm just saying very quickly. So we have villages here around us that you're probably familiar with through wines. Gigondas, Vaqueras, Châteauneuf-du-Pape is not too far, Ségouré, Roix, and so on. So all these AOCs, all these villages that we know from wines. But today I would not like to talk about wines, even though it will come up. But behind me you have an olive tree, and particularly next to me you have a friend of mine, Denis, who is an olive oil producer and knows very, very well olives. And so I would like this morning talk to you a little bit and tell you and find out together with you more about olives. And Denis takes the time to explain us a little bit about olives. And he has another passion, and this other passion are santons. And so we will also learn more about that. And if you don't know what it is, I'm just telling you so much that these are clay figurines that are very popular here and very traditional here in Provence in the nativity scene. Here we are. This is Denis. Denis, thank you for having us. Merci de nous avoir ici.
Avec plaisir et bienvenue à Ségouré. Ségouré, oui, un village avec des vignes, mais il faut penser que l'olivier était avant la vigne et c'était la principale production. Dans ma famille, on était du côté maternel, ils vivaient de l'olivier, et moi j'ai eu cette transmission par rapport à l'olivier, ce bonheur d'avoir cet arbre en culture et justement.
You speak French, no? Ah, we thought you speak French. No, no. Did you not all take French classes? No. Okay, so I will try and translate you a little bit. First of all, welcome in Ségouré. Denis is welcoming us in Ségouré. So this is the village behind us, which we discover later on. Denis comes from Ségouré. His family is here already for generations. And what Denis mentioned already is that the indigenous plant here, before we had all the wines that we are familiar with, we had olive trees here. And also his family, his grandfather and so on, were in had olive trees. And so he has, through his family, through this tradition, he has gotten kind of the seed in him, and that is why he's still taking care of the olive trees.
So. Et du coup, là, vous voyez les olives de cette année. Voilà, ça c'est une variété qui s'appelle la pichouline. C'est une variété pour l'olive de bouche, pour la consommation, pour l'apéritif. Et là, on va bientôt la ramasser pour la confiserie.
Ok, so here we are. So this is one of the local varieties, the pichouline. So actually with olives, it's very similar than it is with grapes. So varieties that grow in particular areas that are particular to certain areas. And this is the pichouline. Pichouline is one that is very, very popular. Pichouline olive is a table olive. What does it mean, a table olive? It means that this is one that we eat. This is not one that we make to tapenade, which is the spread, or that we make oil out of it. We can, but particularly this is for eating. So, and very soon it will be ready to be harvested. That is what they mean.
Donc ça c'est pour la confiserie, pour la bouche, mais il y a aussi, j'ai d'autres vergers où je vais utiliser cette olive là pour justement l'huile d'olive que l'on fait beaucoup plus tard. On va la faire au mois de novembre, décembre.
Ok, so as said again, so this is these ones will be harvested soon. What do we have? We have right now 26th of August, so beginning of September, mid-September it will be harvested. Then he has also other pichoulines in a different orchard, and these ones he will use for olive oil, and these ones will be though harvested much later, in November, beginning of December.
Simplement dire aussi que de toute façon j'ai ma production, mais je sélectionne aussi en France. Je vais en début d'année, à la fin du mois de janvier, je fais toutes les régions oléicoles de France et je sélectionne une huile par appellation, et comme ça je la fais découvrir et je la vends donc dans mon magasin, dans ma boutique.
Okay, Denis is mentioned. So he has not a mill himself. He has some of his own wines, and he brings his olives, and he brings his olives when it's time to harvest to a mill to make oil out of it. But what Denis also does in the beginning of the year, so end of January, generally when most of the oils are done, he makes a tour also France, even though I should say southern France, because olives are only growing in southern France. So we are actually the first, the most northern part where we can grow olives. He does as if he doesn't understand, but he understands a little bit. On est le plus nord en fait ici pour faire
le plus au nord. Ouais. On est la production la plus au nord de la Méditerranée.
The production, the most northern production of the Mediterranean of olives that is here in this area. So when he says he's going around in France, so he stays down here in the south, and then so he visits the different mills or the different olive oil producers, and then he selects certain of those that he likes for particular criteria, and then those of them he will sell in his shop that we will discover in a little bit. I have one question. We know about black olives and green olives, no? Do you have black olives here too? Or?
Non, moi, je n'en fais pas. Mais je fais
he's
simplement.
Not doing making doing black olives.
Black what? Olive is very different because the olive.
Oh, look at that! Oh.
Store red in the pallet box. 7 and 10 days and light fermentation.
Ah, okay.
And the three flavors, the black fruity olive oil is very light.
Okay.
And flavors very different, black olive, tapenade, cocoa.
Okay.
It's special.
Okay.
It's very good.
So the taste is very different. So, well, we maybe have a chance to taste some and we can talk about the aroma. So he's saying coconut, very light, the black olive oil, which is also more rare actually that you get that, but he's not making that out of his olives. Okay, and while Denis is getting ready for us, just another view here through these closest olive trees, and then I'd like to take you in his shop, and not only shop but also workshop, and I think that we can taste some Here we go. So here we have arrived in Denis' shop and workshop, and you will see in a little bit. So this shop here is dedicated to olive. Lavender is never far in Provence. Olives and also Santon. So here just a little idea of the Mediterranean and the French areas where we have and the appellations of olive oils. Here are the olive oils that Denis has decided to represent this year. So down here we have Corsica, for example, Aix-en-Provence, some of you may be familiar with, so this is from Provence, Nice, and then the different areas. AOP, so this is like the AOC, the Appellation Origine Protégée, protected. It's the European label in a way of the AOC. So this makes sure that we really get our olive oil from the area that is stated on the bottle. And here, Ségouré, so just also for you, this is the olive oil here from our region where we are right now. Okay. And then here we see more, so here we, this is what I was saying before, the Santons, and when I say workshop, that this is down here, but there we have just a little glimpse, because now I think, Denis, do you have something for us? Can we try something? There you come. Can we try some olives maybe also? Can we see some olives?
Of course.
Yes? Okay, great. Well, kind of invited myself here. Okay, so here we are, and Denis is ready, and so I am sacrificing myself for you, and I'm gonna try some olives, and he's gonna explain to me, Denis is gonna explain to me a little bit what we do, and I try to explain to you what I taste, and well, we do it together, and
alors,
we see. So we hope you see well.
Alors, je vais te faire goûter la pichouline, qui est l'olive que tu as vue sur l'arbre. Mais là, elle est préparée pour être consommée pour l'apéritif.
Ok, so this is the pichouline. It's green, big, nice one. You see the size around. And that's the same one that we saw out in the sea, that we saw out on the tree. So, and it is what? Qu'est-ce que t'as dit?
Donc là, c'est la pichouline qui a été préparée pour l'apéritif.
Okay, so it was prepared for the aperitif. Oh, the famous aperitif, French aperitif, so I'm going to take my knife.
Alors, il faut penser que c'est une olive qu'on va ramasser fin août, début septembre. Mm-hmm. Par contre, si on laisse cette olive sur l'arbre, elle va se colorer, elle va mûrir et elle va devenir noire.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It's wonderful. It is the I would say the chair, the meat is very strong.
C'est très craquant.
Yeah, craquant. So cracking? No, not crack. It's firm, very firm. Mm-hmm. You can feel the skin a little bit, but it's easy to bite through. Well, then it is prepared. There's some salt and so on, so it has a salty flavor, but it also keeps a sweetness a little bit. Mm. It changes the flavor the longer you have
it. C'est très aromatique.
Yeah, a lot of aromas. It's really a firework. Beautiful, wonderful. Sitting with a glass of rosé, for example, from the area would be very nice. So, Denis was saying, so this is harvested when? In
fin août, début septembre.
Well, end of August, so very soon. The one that he was saying outside that he's gonna harvest soon, so that's the ones from last year, beginning of September. Mm-hmm. And if you leave them longer on the tree, you were saying, s'il reste plus long sur l'arbre?
Il faut penser que les olives, elles sont cueillies vertes pour la bouche, pour la confiserie. Mais si on laisse les olives sur l'arbre, au fil des semaines, au fil des mois, elles vont se colorer et elles vont devenir noires.
Okay.
Il n'y a pas de variété d'olives vertes comme le raisin vert et le raisin blanc et raisin vert.
D'accord.
Là, c'est de toute façon, elles vont se colorer. De toute façon, elles vont devenir foncées, noires.
Ok. So, coming back to the black olives. There are no black olives, really. It's not like in wines where you have white grapes and red grapes. Olives, they are all green. And if you don't harvest them, let's just say September, October, then slowly, slowly, all olives will actually turn black. And then, so that means if you eat black olives, they have been harvested much later than the green ones. And what? But I'm gonna ask now because the flavor is so different. Mais il semble que les noirs souvent ils sont moins remplis d'eau ou ils sont un peu plus. Ou est-ce que c'est la façon comment c'est préparé? I'm asking. They seem the black olives seem often. Maybe you think of the Greek, le grec. Peut-être on pense à cela. The Greek black olives, they seem to be less firm, less liquidy, a little bit mushier, often a little bit sweeter. Donc, I'm going to ask, what's that?
Il faut penser que les olives vertes, à l'intérieur de la pulpe, il y a très peu d'huile. Mm-hmm. Par contre, si on les ramasse comme dans notre région, la région de Nyons, nous les ramassons en surmaturité. Mm-hmm. Nous les ramassons en décembre, janvier. Et là, ce sont les petits sacs où, dans l'intérieur des pulpes où il y a l'huile, les sacs vont être pleins. Donc, on a des différences par rapport au remplissage de l'huile qui se fait au fil des mois.
Donc, il y a quand même un peu un changement qui se fait
à l'intérieur.
C'est pas une couleur, c'est aussi. So there is actually a change with the months also, not only the color, but also what you have is that you have little inside the olive. You have little bags, we are saying, with oil, and with the months, they actually become fuller and fuller of oil. So this is minimal, but this is what gives it this richer and maybe oilier flavor, fatter flavor also to it. Okay,
d'accord. Est-ce que tu veux déguster une olive noire? C'est vraiment l'olive de la région, et elle s'appelle la tanche.
Oui, je veux bien. Est-ce que tu veux bien déguster? Would you like to taste? That's what it means. And yes, oui, I would like to taste. And I can taste now. Denis allows us to have, or permits, or has the option to give us the typical olive from this region, a black olive. So we're going to have that. And the variety is the tanche. And that is very special, if I remember right. C'est très spécial parce qu'il n'y a pas beaucoup de régions qui font la tanche.
Il n'y a que notre région.
It's just here in this region, Nyons, where we have this black tanche. Very different. Very good, I like that too. Comment on peut décrire que c'est différent? How to describe how different it is? What do I place?
Il faut penser que l'olive de nuance, quand on fait déguster des olives, c'est celle qu'on fait déguster la dernière. Mm-hmm. Parce que c'est celle qui a le plus de matière, qui a le plus d'arômes. Mm-hmm. On est sur une huile qui est quand même, une olive qui est un peu grasse quand même. Hein. C'est-à-dire mm-hmm. qu'elle ouais. a beaucoup de goût, parce que justement, dans sa pulpe, quand on la ramasse, mm-hmm. il y a beaucoup d'huile.
Ok. So, in general, the tanche. The oil or also the olive, when we do olive tasting, like wine tasting, we generally taste this one at the end because it has so much flavor. So you remember maybe also if you did a wine tasting or if you did a cheese tasting, that the one with the strongest flavor you taste at the end. So here it's the same. And this is also because it is a little bit of fatty olive, and we all know that if you have some fat in your food, that does give it some flavor. It brings out the flavors. It's a chemical process. So if you have real butter, it does take different. If you have full fat milk, there is more flavor than in zero. So this is why it's a very, very flavorful olive. And it is la tanche.
Alors, par contre, il faut penser que quand on ramasse l'olive pour la bouche, pour la confiserie, on la ramasse en même temps pour l'huile.
So at the same pour la tanche, tu parles.
Oui.
Ouais. So the tanche, this is interesting. This is different than the pichuline, for example. So here we harvest once the tanche. So it's black, and if we make olive oil out of the black one, then we do it right away at the same moment. So there's just this January, let's say, harvest, and then we have the one for the mouth, so the aperitif olive, the one we have just eaten, and at the same time we can do the olive.
Et finalement, au niveau des arômes, avec l'huile, comme avec l'olive de bouche, on va avoir des arômes particuliers. On va avoir des arômes, on est sur le côté fruits secs, amandes, beaucoup amandes.
Ok, so now the olive oil then, so here we get a little bit of description. So this is a very, not sweet, doux, we call it oil. It is not as peppery as the green ones, for example, it could be. And so you have like dried fruit aroma, almond as an aroma in the olive oil.
Et peut-être une dernière chose de dire simplement
que
l'AOP Nuance, c'est la première appellation qui a été créée en France pour l'huile d'olive et pour les olives de bouche. Après il y a eu la vallée des Baux. Ça c'était dans les années, je l'ai pas en tête exactement, okay. Dans les années je pense 93. Okay.
So Denis is, so we are actually here in the motherland of protected olive oils, because the AOP Nyons, so that is the area here that you will find on the label of the olive oil, NYONS. Was the first one, and it's about in 1983, that has received or has also asked for having this protecting, so the appellation of controlled origin or protected origin. So before Le Beau and before other areas, here we had that in Nyons. And of course, Denis and other locals here from that area are very proud of that. And we have a very small production actually compared to other countries and other areas, maybe even in France, but particularly other countries. So there's Greece and there's Spain, of course, and there are other Tunisia and other areas that make a lot in quantity. But in France, it's a small, and Italy, of course, smaller quantity, but very, very high quality. So I don't know if you find some French olive oil at home. Okay, so here we are back again, and we have talked a little bit, and we have talked more olive and more things, and we said, well, I should try some olive oil. And so Denis is inviting us to try one of his oils. So I think you will be able to see. So this is, and there's his name also. So this is the olive oil made out of your olives from...
Oui, ici, et puis il y a aussi en face le village de Séguré, il y a une petite colline qui s'appelle Saint-Joseph.
Ok.
J'ai deux vergers qui sont sur les versants sud, mm-hmm. et c'est pour ça que j'ai appelé la cuvée Saint-Joseph.
Ok, so it's cuvée, like on wines, Saint-Joseph. Because so these olives in there come from a hill or a slope that is just on the opposite side where we're gonna go later on once we leave from here. I'm gonna show you, you can see these olives. And that's why the name is also St. Joseph, because the slope, this hillside is called, is a southern hillside, and it's called Saint Joseph, and it is La Tanche. So it's the Tanche, it's the black one that is typical here for this region.
Alors, Tanche, mais aussi Aglando, okay. La Verdale de Carpentras. Dans mon huile, il y a deux variétés.
Okay.
C'est un mix des deux variétés. Verdale de Carpentras.
Mix de deux. Oh, you understand that? It's a mix of the two. Actually, there's a, how do you call it, Anglo?
Verdale de Carpentras.
Verdale de Carpentras is the other variety. Verdale de Carpentras. Carpentras is a city not far from here. So it is a blend like we do with wines too also here. And so not a monocépage, but it is a blend.
Prends une petite cuillère, voilà, yes, pour la dégustation.
Bon, and it's very healthy in the morning. One little spoon of olive oil before you eat anything else. That is very healthy. Le matin, une petite cuillère de l'huile d'olive, c'est très bon pour la santé.
C'est bon pour la peau.
It's good for skin.
C'est bon pour les articulations.
For the joints.
C'est bon pour les cheveux.
For hair.
Et c'est bon aussi pour la digestion.
For the digestion. It's good for everything and everything. Look at Denis. Okay, good. Okay, so one spoon of olive oil.
Je vais te faire
pour la bonne qualité.
Mais oui, mais surtout pour pouvoir bien ressentir les arômes, juste deux petits conseils.
Okay.
Simplement, je vais te mettre quelques gouttes dans la cuillère, tu vas la sentir et tu vas la mettre en bouche. Et quand tu l'as en bouche, tu vas mélanger de suite avec la salive et tu vas faire tourner quelques secondes. Voilà, je te laisse traduire.
Okay, so he gives me an advice how to taste olive oil. You know, it's not so easy, you cannot just... So a couple of drops are enough because it's very intense. And then I'm going to put that in my mouth. And then it is the best to actually have it right, leave it in the mouth and mix it a little bit with saliva. And have it a couple moments in your mouth and play with it around your tongue so you can feel the aromas all over your tongue and then you just swallow it. So.
Parce que au niveau des arômes que tu vas ressentir, dans la bouche, tu vas voir que l'ardent, c'est l'amertume, mais tous les arômes, il faudra faire rentrer un petit peu d'air par la bouche et souffler par le nez. C'est dans au niveau nasal que tu vas voir tous les arômes.
Yeah, and this is similar as what we say also for the wines. Very often when we do the tasting, you know, when we have this, when we talk about airing, actually oxidation, and so he says that too. So it is good to put oxygen in, have it on the tongue, and then let the oxygen go out through the nose. And it is through the nose that we have then more the aromas better expressed actually. So I'm gonna try to do all that.
Allez, je te mets.
Je vais essayer de tout faire. De tout bien faire. Ok.
Allez, je te mets quelques gouttes.
Ouais.
Oops. Voilà.
Okay. So this is, look at the color, because this also we do that here with olive oil too. Color. Then we smell. It's like with wine. And I can smell it very much. It's nice. And then I put it in my mouth. And then I leave it. Nice. So I have it now all over. I have not swallowed. I have it all over. And I put a little bit air in, and it's very now I swallow. Oui, c'est doux, hein. C'est
alors, il y a de la douceur, mais tu vas voir, il y a l'ardence qui va arriver après. Mais au départ, c'est la noix, c'est la noix fraîche que les arômes que tu reçois, que tu ressens, c'est la noix fraîche. Et après, tu vas voir le végétal qui va arriver.
Ouais, it's true. It's very rich in flavor, but it comes very subtle. It's not very violent. So first, it's true there is something like nuts, fresh nuts. And it stays, I still have to taste, it stays also long, it's very nice. And then it turns, it changes a little bit and it becomes more the végétal, so green plants in that direction.
Alors le végétal, mais pas n'importe quel végétal.
No, not just some végétal, not just some green, no, what green?
on est, quand on mange un avocat, on gratte, quand on est sur la fin, on gratte un petit peu le fond et on a des arômes un peu avocat sur le végétal.
Okay, so you try that one. When you eat an avocado, and at the end, you know, and it was so good that you still want a little bit more, that's you scratch in the skin of the avocado, and it's that flavor that you find in that. So that is a nice one to bring up in your discussion if you taste those friends. Oh, doesn't it taste like a little bit of avocado? Okay, I'm gonna think of that too.
Voilà, mais écoute, okay. Ça c'est ma petite production.
Merci. And again, so this was just from over there, and I maybe actually can already show you just quickly here. I'm gonna turn over there with you, and so this is these are the hills, the slopes over there, and you see maybe the village also up there. We're gonna go there in a second, but just already through the window. So over there, this is where Denis comes from, and but now we say thank you, merci beaucoup, Denis, and thank you for having us. Merci beaucoup, and I hope you enjoyed. And we say goodbye. We're gonna move on to the sun. To Ségurée, that's where we're gonna move on, and there you have already again this beautiful view that I just showed you already through the window at Denis. So this is where Denis grew up, and in a second we're gonna see actually the whole village spreading out over this rolling hill. And on our way there, just a few minutes drive, we will see some beautiful vineyards, and so we will see. Here it comes already. I think we get a glimpse of it. So first of all, you get, of course, an idea what it means driving through the wine country of the Côte du Rhône. And yes, just every day, one day, maybe on your vacation here in Provence. But here you get a view onto some wines. So this could be Grenache. This could be Claret for the white variety, for example, or Mourvèdre or Syrah. So all these are typical varietals that we grow here in the Côte du Rhône to make our wines out of. And we are making our way to Ségurée. I mentioned it again, and there we have this view now on this horizontal line. So that's where it's perched actually, and above and beyond, so you have a lot of vineyards, and here in front of us, of course, too, with the typical soil, quite limey and stony soil, typical for that area. Also the AOC, so for example, you have maybe heard of Châteauneuf-du-Pape, as I mentioned before, or Vacheras or Gigonda. So these are some of the famous appellation or of controlled origin. And so we are heading here then just up, so a few more minutes and then we will be there, and I would like to take you then on a stroll through these this village of Ségurée. We are just strolling through the medieval cobblestone alleys, and maybe we meet some locals. It's lunchtime, so maybe people go to the restaurants, and so we see what's just gonna happen. This should be just for your pleasure as this drive here, to give you just a little bit of view, and I hope you enjoy it. And then after that, well, it's time to say goodbye. So yeah, but about 10 minutes, if you look further on, so this is also where you just drive around and you have these caves. We saw just the sign C-A-V-E-S, like cave. That means cellar in French, and that's just where you stop and you can taste some wines, not always cost something. Or then you can go into the villages directly, of course, also where you have everywhere this tasting places. But now we get closer, we arrive, and I see you in a second. Hello, here we are back again on the road. Here we are in the wine country of the Côte du Rhône. I'm in Ségurée right now, one of the wonderful medieval villages of this area. So we are just about 40 kilometers north of Avignon. And what you see behind me is the beautiful mountain country, a little glimpse of it, of this area. And so I would like to take you now just inside the village, and I needed to show you this. Look above me, isn't it great? I know it's not great to be filmed from underneath, but with this above me, it's quite nice, isn't it? So these are these famous plane trees. Sycamore family plane trees, but these are here. Look at this behind me. I love it. It's just a parking lot. So here we come to the entrance of the village. I want to take you. So this is a fortified village. And so we discover a little bit together for a couple minutes. And we are making our way. I don't want to hold you too long. And here on the side we have the former laundromat, public laundromat, where I guess back then it was women that came out here and were washing. What is still running. So here, see, and here then you would wash. So this is all before we enter actually into the village itself. So there we get some description also. So in the 14th century, this village was pillaged, and we lost a lot of the information about this village because of big fires that were taking place. Actually, right now here also it is summer, and we have a lot of fires. Actually, just yesterday, several in this area too. Thinking of everyone who is in California right now, of course. And in the 19th century, early 19th century, we had these laundromats, as I call it, revitalized, because they were, of course, forgotten and left behind. So now I'd like to enter the village. Let's go and let's see what we discover together. Here, this is the entrance gates. Actually, you see pretty much what we see, what we leave behind, no? But that's maybe not too bad. Now let's go further up. So we have a lot of stone, as you can imagine. So I'm walking straight one way through, I was thinking, and this is the main street. And so this is a perched village on a cliff, on a hillside. And so behind me, we could go up. We see if we do that later, but for now, we're just going straight. And it is lunchtime. I don't take a break. It is lunchtime and people are busy. There is the Mesclun, which is probably the most popular restaurant here in Ségoré. Not making advertisement, but a lot of discussion going on. But you see, this is the terrace here. And very popular place. People are just so you see where we go in this direction further on. Just straight ahead, and we have a look. So yes, wouldn't that be nice here with a glass of rosé from the area? Well, maybe we'll do that later. So, now here, this is interesting. I could show you this one here. So look here down, which looks like a basement or a hole. It's not. This is actually in the 15th century, 16th century, when the situation became a little bit safer, actually, in these hilltop towns. Because why are these villages in hilltops, on hilltops? Not because everyone loved to walk up a hill. No, it's because it's the safest place. You see your animal arriving. But once the situation became a little bit safer for a lot of people, thinking, becoming safer, they were opening up these fortifications, or the walls, actually, which were surrounding the villages. And then we have exits to go down. So we could have gone down through this hole, and we would have come out at the street just below. And then just here, I wanted to show you also this view. So this is above me. So this is connecting two buildings. You see how you maybe get off signal, get your motion sickness pills out. So this is connecting the two sides of the buildings. And so we continue on, and now maybe, hold on, let's try this. That should work, and it does. So you don't have to look at me anymore. I think this is enough. So now this is where we walk. So this is solid stone. And what you see here also, so you can see that these are not carved stones. So we go back, really 12th century, 13th, 14th, of course, all the way through. So these are, some of them are carved and others are naturally picked up in the field. So these are the typical limestones here of that area, and then built and constructed on that. On we have the walls, or the houses, of course, for that matter, the buildings. Let's continue on a little bit. Oh, there's somebody having lunch up there. There's a peach tree. I don't know if you can see that. Just, can you see up there the peaches? There we go.
Well, for a lot of my friends here in Europe, it's lunch break, so I wish you a good lunch. I hope you enjoy. If you're in the city, getting out in the countryside a little bit. And for those of you that are waking up in the US, I hope you enjoy waking up with Provence on your screen. Just a teaser, so I hope soon you will be able to come back and you come and visit me. So here we could go further around the corner, but let's just continue, as we said, our walk. I'm gonna turn around. Pardon. Encore bon appétit. Oui, d'accord.
Est-ce que vous voulez... C'est la Provence.
Wow. C'est la Provence, c'est l'accueillante, non? Voilà. La Provence est accueillante,
non, surtout. Non, j'ai des dames là.
Bon, j'espère que ça va.
Et on n'invite pas tous les gens qui passent.
Non, mais je vois bien, je passe pour la deuxième fois. I'm sorry for this interruption, but these ladies who are saying, so they sit here together and have lunch. I think there are shop owners here, wonderful, and there's some works going on, so I don't know if you can hear me actually. Oh, I wanted to sit down here, but I think I don't do that with the works. Let me get away from here. To hear mon cœur. Are you coming, my heart? En plus. Et le cœur. The cœur has arrived. Bon, I'm gonna go up. So everyone is quite relaxed. So I'm gonna tell you a little bit. The ladies first. So they were eating out and having their lunch there. And then one of them said, oh, and how is it with the right of author and the jazz? And then we were joking. And then they said, well, we are not inviting everyone who comes by for lunch. And I said, well, I come by for the second time. I said, well, come a third time and you will be invited. And this woman here, just with her son, she was calling him, do you come, my heart? And she heard me that I translated for you, and she was laughing and she says, oh yeah, well, and then he was back, the heart, her son was back. So I'm taking you here just a little bit further, and some people walking and coming, so voila voila. I think you got an appetite either for food or for Provence Village, and I hope you enjoyed. And I definitely will look for some lunch for me too now. And thank you for watching, for checking out. And more to come, more to come. Our days in Provence. Bye bye.